First thing I have this morning is the sounds of Mother's Day. A mixer whirs out of control and stops abruptly as a voice cries, "I'm telling." A dog barks and another voice says, "Get his paws out of there. Mom has to eat that." Minutes pass by and finally, "Dad, where's the chili sauce?" Then, "Don't you dare bleed on Mom's breakfast." The breakfast is fairly standard, a word tumbler of juice, 5 pieces of black bacon that snap in half when you breathe on them, a mound of eggs that would feed an army division, and 4 pieces of cold toast. And then the kids line up by the bed to watch you eat, and from time to time I ask, "Why are you not drinking your Kool-Aid?" Or touching the cantaloupe with black olives that spill long. Later in the day, you have decided it's easier to move to a new house than to clean the kitchen, and you return to your bed where, if you're wise, you reflect on the day, and for the first time, you realize your children have decided to give rather than receive, and they've offered the highest form of flattery, and that is to imitate, to emulate what you do for them every day. You don't have to look very far to find a description of the ideal woman that God shares with us in His Word. If you would, turn to the book of Proverbs, chapter 31. Proverbs chapter 31, beginning in verse 10. Who can find a capable wife? She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will not lack for anything good. She rewards him with good, not evil, all the days of her life. She selects wool and flax and works with them with her hands. She is like a merchant ship bringing her food from afar. She rises while it is still night and provides food for her husband, for her household, and portions for her servants. She evaluates a field and buys it and plants a vineyard with her earnings. She draws her strength and reveals that her arms are strong. She sees that her prophets are good and her lamp never goes out at night. She extends her hands to the spinning staff, and her hands hold the spindle. Her hands reach out to the poor, and she extends her hands to the needy. She is not afraid for her household when it snows, for her and her household are doubly clothed. She makes her own bed, coverings, her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known at the city gates, where he sits with among the elders of the land. She makes and sells linen garments. She delivers belts to the merchants. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she can laugh at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and loving instructions is on her tongue. She watches over the activities of her household and is never idle. Her sons rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also praises her. Many women are capable, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord will be praised. Give her the reward of her labor, and let her work praise her at her city gates. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, bless the leering of your word. And I pray that you would hide me behind the cross, O God, that they would not see me, but see you through me. I just pray, dear God, that your word, your will, be accomplished. For it is in your holy name I pray. Amen. Amen. This proverb is God's description of the ideal woman. Now, God is not chauvinistic. He does not place undue expectations on a woman. He knows what a woman is worth. He knows her value and knows what she's capable of. And in this reading, we get a glimpse of what he considers the ideal woman. Keep in mind, this proverb wasn't written to make you feel guilty or place unrealistic expectations on your wife. It was written to build you up and to show you God's given potential. Let's notice two items about the ideal woman. First, she is a valuable wife. Ladies, this isn't to say that you'll never fulfill your role in life if you're single. Just the opposite. God sets aside women that are single to do His work to the fullest. But a woman who is married and can take care of her household and take care of her family is blessed. You know what makes her such a valuable wife? Let's look at verses 10 through 12. Who can find a capable wife? She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will not lack anything good. She rewards him with good, not evil, all the days of her life. She earned her husband's respect by working with him instead of against him. What an example to follow. Husbands and wives, moms and dads, work together as a team and don't compete as opponents. You're on the same team, and you have the same goal: to build, provide for, and maintain a godly family. And ladies, you can be a valuable wife if you work with your husband to reach that goal. Second, she is a vigorous worker. She works hard at home. Verses 15 and 27, she rises while it is still night and provides food for her household and portions for her female servants. She watches over the activities of her household and is never idle. They say that a woman's work is never done, and that's especially true of a woman's work at home. I know of a couple of examples in my household. If you clean the living room and walk away for 5 minutes, it's like a tornado came through, and her name was Emily. Same is true with her room and any other room that she goes into. She has a unique talent for putting things where they don't belong and putting things everywhere that didn't have a place for it to begin with. We try to limit the amount of toys that she has just because we can't pick up so many things a day. Mm-hmm. Many of y'all can look back at your children and remember those fun times of days and dread the days that somebody's going to come visit, because that means you have to actually get down and clean up everything, and that means a lot of work from day break to day end. A mother has to be a nurse. This is why a mother is more of a specialized task than any other. Because in no other profession do you have to be a nurse, a teacher. Matt, turn the game down a little bit on my microphone, please. Thank you. A child psychologist, a dietitian, a housekeeper, and a good cook. It takes hard work to build it and maintain a family. So ladies, when it comes to being a household provider and a mother, it is not easy. It is very difficult. But most of y'all have survived it. And the ones that have not, we'll send them cards to the sanitarium later on today, see how they're doing and check on them. She works hard on the job. It says in the verse that in 18 and 24, she sees that her profits are good and her lamp never goes out at night. She makes and sells linen garments and delivers belts to the merchants. Now these verses describe the career woman. In most of our households today, it takes a two-wage-earning family to make ends meet. So ladies, not only get to be mom, a teacher, a child psychologist, a dietitian, but you work outside the home as well, putting in your 8 hours a day just to come home and take care of a household with youngins running around. It takes a lot. But the Bible says not to condemn a woman who works outside the home. The ideal woman of Proverbs 31 works outside the home and is commended, not condemned. If you have to work outside the home, and take advantage of it and focus on ministering to your husband and raising your children. But if you have to find employment outside the home, then don't feel like a bad wife or a bad mother. You are being a good wife and a good mother because you're helping provide for your family. It says that she even works hard when she shops. But let me tell you, my wife works extremely hard when it comes to shopping. She can work on the way to shopping with yard sales and flea markets. She can even work hard while she's on the computer shopping. So while you're out there working hard, remember, shopping is a part of your work. So don't feel bad about it. Amy goes, what? Yes. Right. She's also a virtuous woman. Our society places a lot of emphasis on a woman's looks, but there's more to the ideal woman than her looks. She has substance and virtue. Verse 20 describes the compassion she shows. Verse 25 describes the character she has. And verse 26 describes the counsel she gives. To sum it all up, the ideal woman is Christ-like. What an example you have to follow. Now, there's nothing wrong with wanting to look your best, but remember, it's far more important to be a woman of substance and virtue, like the woman in Proverbs 31. You need to really get acquainted with this woman and make her your role model. Follow her example, and you will have help and find fulfillment and satisfaction. I can close here, but there's one more thing I want to mention to you. The praise she deserves. It says in verses 28 through 31, her sons rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also praises her. Many women are capable, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord will be praised. Give her the reward of her labor and let her works praise her at the city gates. For the most part, I preach to the ladies, and I don't want the rest of you to feel left out, so let me preach a few minutes to the men. The last four verses of the proverb says that a godly woman deserves to be praised. Husbands, teenagers, children, do you know we ought to praise the godly women in our lives? First, because it feels good. It feels good to be positive and say positive things of the people in your lives. But there are some people who just don't like to be praised others. I'm talking about the cranks, the misfits, the Scrooges of the world who seldom praise. They have an inner sickness of the soul that yields criticism, complaining, sarcasm, and a general joylessness. I want to take such people, and sometimes myself, and shake them and say, wake up. Wake up. God has given you blessings. Many people here today still enjoy having their mother with them. This is the first Mother's Day I'll have without my mother. But I know where she's spending her Mother's Day. And I think that is a much better place than being here. I can't put into words the joy that I feel when I think about Mom spending this day in heaven. So be with her mom on Mother's Day. There are always temptations that try to lure us away from God, and we all need encouragement from time to time. We all need to hear a saintly person say, you're doing a great job. When you praise the God of women in your life, you are strengthening the walk in the Lord. As I said, my mom passed on the 2015, and that was just one day after my birthday. And then for a while I thought, that was sure was generous of God to not let it be my birthday. Not that it be a day like that. But you know, I think about it, and I celebrate my birthday and I celebrate her homecoming. So I wouldn't have a problem, I think, either way with it, if she would have passed on my birthday or not. I grew up with my mom. Many of you grew up in Christian homes and had godly families, and that wasn't my childhood at all. I did not grow up with my mother. I was raised by my aunt and my grandmother. And in that, I had a lot of hard times with my mom. She had a lot of times that she was going to come visit me and then didn't come. And it was just a very strained relationship. But as I grew older, we became friends. And we had a special friendship. So husbands, teenagers, and children, praise her while you still have her, and you will strengthen her, honor her, and add great joy to your own life. Verse 28 again says, her sons rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also praises her. Let us pray. If you would please stand with your eyes closed, heads bowed.